In the summer of 2017, Mass Anthem planned to do a 2-month tour. What happened during that summer changed everything. I was close to giving up. I was close to throwing in the towel. Couldn't see the light at the end of that tunnel. I was tired and broken down. The tour started at the end of May, where we rehearsed our live show off of our newly recorded album Through People Like Me for the first time. It took us 5 days. Mass Anthem's sound had completely changed. Tyler was no longer playing on drums. We had 2 lead vocalists, and Tyler was on drum pad, and we had to recreate our live show. And we were just super excited to get to work and get the summer started off right.
So we just finished our first full band practice for the summer tour, where we're playing at camps and churches. And then we're gonna work on our entire record, figure out our entire show, the choreography for it, stage plot, all that good stuff.
Those 5 days were pretty stressful. We had just gotten back from Spring Hill, and we had to like create a full show in 5 days and just be ready to hit the road. And I remember on the last day specifically, something went haywire in our system, in our sound system. And it took us like 8 hours to figure out how to fix.
The whole
and
day.
So technically we did it in 4 days, and we both cried on that day.
it was a really, really stressful day. It was one of those days where every little thing that can go wrong goes wrong.
The day before we're supposed to leave, we're like, this is awesome.
But
glory to
God, we knew the right people to help us get it fixed. And it got fixed.
Got fixed.
So basically what we're doing, we're going to be a 3-man band, all in the front. So basically Chad's going to be the singer, right over here. Follow me along this way. Chad, lead singer. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to be like for King and Country. Like, you know, the two brothers like singing and stuff. And it's running around switching stages and stuff. So Chad's going to come over here, play Joey's keyboard while Joey's like soloing and tearing people's faces off. And I'm going to come over here and play the keyboard, and Chad's going to go play the drum pad. We're going to be doing a lot of switching instruments. It's going to be super fun. Can't wait to rehearse it and show the world. I'm super excited for the summer. One, because we took April and May off to finish the record. And two, because I am doing something completely different that I have never done before. So I've played the drums for 12 years, and with our new live show, I'm no longer gonna be playing the drums. So super different, I'm gonna be singing a lot more, but I'm really excited about it. I think it's gonna be something new that people haven't seen before. And so I'm really excited to show everyone our live show, and just have a lot of fun. Like, I finally get to like jump around and dance on stage, which I'm super excited about, because I never get to do that.
Hi, everybody. We are in the studio practicing for our live show today. And as you can see from him, we are tired.
We are already tired, and it is day three of tour. We haven't even gone anywhere. We've been in the same place.
So when we were practicing for the 5 days for our live show, we really didn't have any place to stay, just because asking someone to stay for 5 days is a really long time. That's a big commitment. And we really didn't know like our schedules and stuff when we were practicing at Judson. And so we literally slept in Studio B. For five days. So like the shower situation was really rough. We had to go to the fitness center, call campus safety to unlock the shower.
So totally.
What we did for like beds and stuff is one of us slept on the couch in the Studio B, and then I remember I took the absorption panels off of a microphone stand, little foam pieces, and laid that down like a mattress. And slept on that. And thinking back, I can't believe that we did that. Not even just for one night, but like day after day after day.
It's crazy.
Doing that. And then like working for like 8 or 10 hours in the day working on our live show. Like that was just a recipe for disaster.
The studio is kind of like our home. These are all of our clothes. And we kind of need to clean up a ton of stuff. So we have a lot to do before we leave. This is what happens when you live here for 3 days.
I would say the hardest thing about living on the road for 2 months, you're not going home for 2 months, is that you have to pack a lot of clothes. And packing a lot of clothes, your clothes end up all in different areas. So I have 3 different suitcases and a 4th bag all of my bathroom stuff. Well, I grabbed the wrong bag of clothes for the place that we were staying at last night. So my suitcase is in our trailer back where we're rehearsing. It's about 20 minutes away. And I really don't have any clothes. So, in the same outfit as yesterday.
So we set out for Spring Hill, Michigan for our first summer gig. It was a training weekend for the summer counselors, and we were the worship band for that weekend. So it was a great opportunity for us to just get our blood pumping, and we were on fire. We just rehearsed for 5 days, and it was a great opportunity for us to see the reactions that people would get when we would lead worship for them with our new setup.
Merch is pretty fun setting up because this is where we get to meet everybody. I think sometimes people are afraid to come to our merch tables. I think the main reason is because they think we're cool, but we're not. We're not cool.
Today is our last day in Michigan at Spring Hill.
Oh, hey everybody. Like Joey said, it's our last day at Spring Hill. We are hitting the road in 2 hours-ish. And then gonna find a campground up north in Michigan. We're DJing a wedding tomorrow, which should be super fun. And yeah, we don't have a place to stay between now and then, so campground.
So after having an awesome weekend, we set out for Charlevoix, Michigan, which is way at the top of Michigan near Canada. And Chad and Tyler were DJing a wedding for a friend from college. And we didn't really have anywhere to stay along the way. So we found a free campground and we pitched our tent, which didn't have a top on it.
Who says a couple musicians can't make a fire?
Oh yeah.
But we survived. We lived off of Oreos and Doritos and marshmallows and we made ourselves a little fire and we pulled through.
You got it.
Here's what I'm thinking.
Alright, here we go.
Here we go.
Ingenuity.
Yeah!
That was easy.
I feel like Joey was a little impressed.
We woke up at a campground and then we went to a wedding rehearsal.
Yes. Mm-hmm. We didn't shower.
It's like 7 a.m. right now, and last night was cold, like really cold. We got like in the 30s last night. After the wedding, we drove south to our first youth group gig. We've made it to Marysville. Now it's time to set up.
So, the vlog where we were at Marysville, Michigan, which is literally like a stone's throw away from Canada. That was our very first show where we were doing our live set that we had worked on for a long time.
Yeah, our original music.
Mm-hmm. And so we're like super pumped about it. And then like 4 hours before the event was supposed to start, the pastor got us together and all the volunteers together and said that there was a teen who lived in that area that had just committed suicide. And a lot of the students that were coming to the event knew this kid. And we were just shocked because, I mean, we really didn't know how to go about the rest of the night then, because we had this whole night plan for the youth and we were going to go crazy and have fun and jump around and stuff. And so many of the students were coming in just crying, just like brokenhearted. I just felt like the Lord said, you know, I want Hero, your song Hero, to be about this story, you know, for the rest of the summer tour. And so we just kind of shared from the stage that, man, there are so many people who go through life thinking that they don't have a hero, which is why we, you know, revert to hurting other people or hurting ourselves. And in this situation with Hero, I think he even redeemed what happened that night, and it from such a tragic thing that happened.
It was awesome.
It was pretty awesome.
That night was a night that fueled our energy for the rest of the tour. Every concert from then on, we would tell that story from the stage before we would sing the song Hero. And just to see the impact that that story has had on people is just amazing. So we packed up our gear and we were just ready to take on the rest of the summer. And thankfully, we slept in beds that night.
Everybody wrote words of encouragement for us on the chalkboard. This is really cool. Keep on running. Pun intended. I like it. Who did that?
I don't know.
Thank you for coming, Gideon. We thank you, Gideon.
The show went really, really well. Thank you to all the people who helped us out. Literally everything, from the food to the merch table to the lights, the sound. Thank you everyone for helping us make this show possible. So it is 10 o'clock. We're going to head to Danville, Michigan, where we will spend the night. And then tomorrow morning, we are leaving for Davis, Illinois, my hometown. Leaving the house now. We are in lovely Danville, Michigan. Hopefully we'll get to Illinois by, probably like 5 hours from now, maybe less. But then once we reach Illinois, we have another like hour or 2 hours. And we're staying at my house and we're playing at my church on Tuesday. So we're really excited for that. At my house, we eat a bunch of breakfast food.
Hello. Don't even do this.
So we got to go home to Nashville for one day,
like right
for all
middle.
Of June and July, like yeah. Right in the middle. Yeah. So we got to see our girlfriend's fiance mm-hmm. at the time, and it was really good to just be home, just for that one day.
Hey, Joey. We're at a Kohl's right now.
Sorry.
I'm just bumping into my mom there. I need to get some shorts.
$30 at Kohl's cash.
So I need to find a pair of jean shorts for the Freedom Fest, because I got a really nice like American flag bro tank, and just no shorts to go with it. So.
Being away from home for a month at a time is just insanity. It doesn't make sense to do that. So,
yeah.
We're not gonna.
I'm not gonna do it.
Well,
Miss Minister,
I got some Jords.
You got some drawers,
and they're legit.
Baby. Oh, I got
for $9 at bargain.
I have
hunt
to take
store.
A picture of his drawers.
The compassion experience is happening in the truck back that way towards the 10 times.
Hi guys, about to go on
there,
Freedom Fest.
Away,
bomb!
Three family four packs.
Freedom Fest was like the halfway point of the tour for us. So the first month of the tour was located in the Midwest, and we were super excited because we were going to the Northeast, and so we were going to be on the East Coast for an entire month.
We made it through Cleveland, Ohio. We're stopping for gas right now. We're almost to like the little part of Pennsylvania, and then I'm pretty sure after that, we're in New York. Super excited. Never been to New York before. We've made it to New York, the state, not the city. We made it to our hotel. We are, we're gonna drop the trailer off, and then we're gonna go visit Niagara Falls, because we're about 30 minutes from there. Like I said, we found a place to sleep tonight. That's great.
We find ourselves having a lot of downtime on the road when we're like going from place to place, especially if we tour something. And we really just like to sightsee when we're going out, just because we don't know the next time we're going to be there again, if ever. And so going to Niagara Falls, we went to. That was amazing.
This place is amazing. Biggest waterfall I've ever seen. So, haven't seen that many, but this one tops them all.
So the first half of the tour was pretty much throughout the Midwest, Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, and Wisconsin. And then in July, we headed out to the East Coast and to probably our favorite place, which is Hebron, New Hampshire, for a camp called Camp Berea. And just super chill. It's like on a beautiful lake, and they have a 60-foot cliff that you can jump off of.
It's like 15 minutes from the camp.
Yeah. And so we did it, and it was scary, but amazing.
Mm-hmm. Jump, you'd have to go down in like as a pencil, because if you like left your arms out, it smacking the water hurts so bad, and your jaw. I remember smacking my jaw. It was fun.
Tyler,
anything you need?
Don't lose the
phone.
Oh, that hurt really bad.
Ooh, do it for the vlog.
Oh, minor casualty.
Minor. You feeling all right?
We arrived in New Hampshire sometime after 12:30 last night. We'll be at this camp for the next 2 weeks. We're super excited to be here.
Oh, yeah, you can have some of it.
Oh my gosh, it's so good.
It is.
Syrup.
Straight up.
That is syrup.
Straight up syrup.
It is unlike any kind of syrup that you have ever had if you're not from the East Coast, because it is like a runny, liquidy. It's not
Mrs. Butterworth.
Mrs. Butterworth. Butterworth is a sorry excuse for what this is. $100. No. Yeah, this is going to be awesome. So, got some syrup.
We brought in our own
New Hampshire syrup. And we're going to pound some pancakes.
I'm not going to waste
any time.
What do you have to say for yourself?
I'm disgusted.
So, like, our favorite, one of our favorite things about, like, what we do, especially during the summer, is when we go play at festivals and we get to meet, like, a bunch of different bands that we look up to and admire. So, over this summer, we played with Jordan Feliz, and we got to meet him, and he was super cool, really down to earth. And then we played a festival, Hillfest, in New Hampshire, with Phil Wickham. And he was just so nice. I remember we even jumped like in the VIP line just to meet him, like after we were done playing. We're like, yeah, we're one of the bands, just got done playing, and we just really like your music. And he was so down to earth too, and he just asked us, so like, what are your guys' dreams as a band? And he just like, he was awesome. And what was super funny was during his set, he said, after one of his songs, he's like, hey, well, can we thank all the other bands who were here? And he said, you know, he said all the bands, all the artists, and then he said, and we wanted the, you know, Mass Anthem too. And I remember Joey turned to us and was like, guys, our band name just came out of Phil Wickham's mouth. So funny.
Made it to Boston.
It's raining.
It's raining outside.
It's raining water.
It feels like Jesus is sneezing.
So the cool thing about being in a band is on our off days, we get to sightsee if we're near something we want to see. So we were really close to Boston. We just went downtown for the day where it was raining all day and it was chilly, but it was awesome. We all got to hang out together and it was a lot of fun.
You
guys
want to see
the dad wave? Yeah. Yeah, totally.
We're wet.
We're wet.
Definitely wet.
Could you tell?
So after Boston, we headed down south to Virginia, and it was a little outdoor concert that we played for a church, and it was awesome because we got to play on two truck beds. That was really cool. And then the next day we went to Washington, D.C., because I think we were only like an hour away or something. So on our off day, we got to see Washington, D.C. So Washington Monument there, and we have the White House there, and then we have the Lincoln Memorial there. After our time in the Virginia, D.C. area, we had to drive back up the way we came back to camp and do another week. And so along the way, obviously, we had to make a stop in New York City. All right, we have arrived. And now we're going to look for some dollar pizza. First stop. So many people. I thought Chicago had...
There's like definitely more than 100 people living here.
So out of the 6 hours that we got to spend in New York on our way back to New Hampshire, it was just awesome. We tried to see as much as we could. We went to the 9/11 Memorial and we got some dollar pizza and we just walked around and looked at buildings and just we went to Times Square. It was super awesome. So on our way back, we found out that Mike Donaghy from 10th Avenue North was going to actually be at this camp. And he was there and he did like a little campfire session. It was really awesome to just meet one of our heroes and one of our bands that we look up to. So it is 7:40 p.m. We are about to do something either really smart or really stupid.
Yes.
We will document everything.
All of it.
Tonight is our last night of tour.
We
are going home. The only thing is, mm-hmm. We have about a 20-hour drive.
We're going to try to do this 20-hour drive without stopping.
Man, guys, we're leaving after 2 months. We have a 20-hour drive ahead of us. We're leaving at 9 p.m.
We don't drink energy drinks, but that night we had Red Bull, and we were wired for a while. Chad crashed at about 5 a.m., and then Tyler started driving, and then I drove at the end. And eventually we got home. It turned out to be like a 22-hour drive, but we made it.
I remember we got home from that summer tour, 2 months, and we, that night, we were sitting on the couch or something.
I don't know what to do with my life now that tour's over. I just sit here at my desk.
And we like didn't know what to do with ourselves. The tour was over, we didn't have much booked. We came out with the album and we just did the whole tour based on the album and then it was over. And we're like, well, what do we do now? And we just kind of came to this place in our career and I guess just like personally that, you know, we're just going to try to do this independently. For so long we've been searching for a record label and putting our hopes and dreams in what a label can give for us and do for us. And we just decided let's just work really hard at what we do and try to do our best at it and whatever happens, happens. And it was seriously like a week later, we got a call from an A&R guy from Dream Records. Hadn't even heard of it. It's insane how when we just changed our mindset and, you know, put our career in the hands of the Lord rather than what a label can do, he just opens doors. And we were just searching for a team, really, that they were experts in their field and they would allow us to be experts in ours, and they were just as passionate in our dreams and goals for the band as we were. And that's really what we were praying for. And then Dream came along and they kind of fit that description exactly. But it's just cool to see that when
when you say yes to the will of God and he opens doors, he doesn't just like stop opening doors. And when you're in the will of God and when you put him first and trust him with your life, with your career, with your family, relationships, everything, you really can't out-give God. You can't out-trust him, I guess. Hmm. Like he always, you know, will bless you when you trust him with your life and your plans and when you surrender to him. So that's exactly what he's been doing with us. And as a band, we, you know, need to decide like every single day, like what does success mean to us? Mm-hmm. And like every couple weeks we have to define that again for us because an opportunity will come along and we just, you know, define it as if music can provide for our families, then that's success. And if providing for all of our families means that we only play for 10 people on a weekend, that's providing for our families, and that's success to us. And if that means that we play for 10,000 on a weekend, all right. Whatever music looks like for us, it's just so that we can enjoy, do what we love to do, and it benefit, you know, our families.
Yeah, there really isn't one way of doing music anymore. You know, even 5-10 years ago, it was, you need the record label, and then you need to get on radio and all this. And now it's like, there's streaming and Spotify and YouTube. It's like, you don't even necessarily need that stuff anymore. So when we changed our mindset from, we don't need a record label, like, we can do it by ourselves, it really just changed our entire outlook on music and being able to do it, really encouraged us. Made it even more cool that Dream came. You know, we got a call from Dream a week later. But I think for each band or musician, like whatever you're doing, you need to define for yourself what success means. Because it's different for everybody. You know, it's like Chad said, for us, it's we want to provide for our families. Bottom line, that's it. You know, for some people, it might be, I want to have a number one single on the radio. You know, we'd love for that to happen, but it's not necessarily a main goal of ours. So I think, like, define what it is that you want to accomplish with your music. This kind of love that we have for music can be shared with people, and people catch on to it, and they, like, want it. Mm-hmm. And so I think that, like, people genuinely enjoyed our show because it stirred something in them that was like, wow, these guys are, like, there's something different about them. So yeah, for us, just success is, I feel like we're already successful. We're doing what we love with the people we love, you know, supporting ourselves as best we can, and just, the sky's the limit, and we're just going to keep working hard. Yeah. And that's the goal. We're never, ever settling for, you know, we might have a record deal and a song on the radio or whatever, but it's like, man, what like, let's keep going. You know, it's a constant, like, we have this conversation all the time. Yeah. Like, every day is, like, what can we do today to, like, better our career as musicians?
So let's say you're a band that is just starting out, and say you're in college or high school, and you want to be a Christian band, and you want to, you have your dreams and goals. So what are some actual things that we can do to kind of get a jump start on your career? And like Tyler said, there's really no one way of doing things anymore. But just based on our experience, here are some things that you can take away from what has helped us. And one thing is that really helped the band is playing at camps. And by playing at camps, and I know before I was with these guys, you guys did like 10 weeks of camp.
Yeah, doing camps is great because there's a lot of, it's like, the, you know, kids, middle school kids and high school kids, like, they're going to love you and they're going to follow you, like, your whole career. And so it's cool to, like, get them young. And then also just playing at camps, like, you're just playing over and over. You're playing bunches and bunches of sets. So you're just getting better at performing. Yeah.
So by playing at these camps, you run into youth groups and youth leaders and different churches. So that opens up more doors for you as a band to play shows at these churches and play your own music, because when you're playing at camps, most of the time you're leading worship. But by meeting these youth groups, you get to play at their churches and play your music, and so that's how you get more exposure.
Social media is also a big part of what we do. And it's not necessarily, like, don't think that you have to post, like, every day. Post, like, the best content to get really, really specific, to get engagement. You want people to, on Facebook, you want people to like and comment and share. You know, and on Instagram, you want people to like and follow your stories. And so it's just really important that you're posting, like, relevant content that your fans want to see, want to hear. And that you're keeping people engaged so that they want to be a part of things.
The last thing is just to always be working on your craft. Yeah, what's really important is songwriting. I am not the best songwriter in the world, but I work really hard at it. And I'm willing to understand that every song I write is not going to be a good one. And I think it's really important to just keep doing it, keep working really hard at it, day in and day out, always keep your mind and eyes open for inspiration and, you know, always be reading or hearing good quotes or listening to audiobooks, just always feeding that creative part of you. And then just putting it to pen to paper, just practicing it, just grabbing a guitar, grabbing your computer, building a track. For me, songwriting, I always write best when I hear just a really good song and I kind of write something that I was inspired by when I heard that song. So just always just working at it and looking for inspiration.